So some problem-solving strategies. One of which is algorithm. Now, algorithm, by definition, assuming it's a solvable problem, is a step-by-step procedure guaranteed to produce a solution. If it's solvable and you apply the correct algorithm, the problem will be solved. That's how computers work. Computers are able to systematically apply rules sequentially until they exhaust all possibilities, but most humans don't think like that. But you could. If you've got an old briefcase or an old bike lock with a three-digit combination on it and you don't remember the combination anymore, there is an algorithm that solves that problem. 000. Nope. 001. Nope. Etc., 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 etc. Somewhere between 000 and 999 is the correct answer. But you would have to go through every single possibility. If you did, though, you'd be guaranteed to get the answer if you have the patience. If you don't make an error in your implementation, you'll eventually get it right. So if I want pickles and I'm over at Kroger and I don't know where the pickles are, or maybe I'm in a new store, because I know where pickles are in Kroger, because that's where I go. Go over to Food City where my wife goes. I don't know where they got anything over there. Now I want to find them. I could implement an algorithm guaranteed to find a solution. All I got to do is go down row one like this. No pickles, no pickles, no pickles, no pickles, no pickles, no pickles. No pickles, no pickles, no pickles, no pickles. Eventually, I'm going to go through all of row one, all of row two, both sides, row three, four, five, seven, whatever it is, I'm going to find them pickles, assuming I don't make a mistake. If I apply the algorithm, I'm guaranteed to find a solution. It's a solvable problem, but I may not want to do that because that's a pain in the ass and I don't want to stay there all day. But eventually it'll work. What I'm more likely to do is take a shortcut, a heuristic. So that's what we usually do as human beings. We see a problem. We know there might be a solution if we apply a rigorous, time-consuming method. Isn't there a shortcut? So if you wanted to solve your password problem, what's your password? Well, you probably can't do it depending on how complicated it is if you really have no clue. But a computer could, because it can apply an algorithm of every possible letter combination, capitalization, no capitalization, every possible number combination, every possible character combination. Eventually, depending on the complexity of it, encryption and all that other stuff aside, it would come up with a solution. But us, we're not going to have that kind of discipline of mind or dedication to the task. We're likely to start going, what was your pet's name? You know, what's the most common password? Password. First thing you want to do if you want to crack a password is try the word password. Most of the, or I guess the people who use the simple ones, they're more likely to use that one than anything else. Then they use pet names, birthdays, things that are personally relevant to them. So that what you're not cracking is the entire combination, but the combination of things that are meaningful to individual people, which is a heuristic. It's a shortcut. Not guaranteed to find a solution. But if you know yourself well enough and you can't remember your own password, as long as it doesn't lock you out, you probably know different kinds of password combinations. In fact, most people use similar units. They might use a pet's name or a child's name or a date of birth or a significant event like an anniversary. They might always use an exclamation point or always use an underscore. And what they've done is they just moved combinations of that very familiar set of elements around to create new passwords. So that would be a heuristic to help you solve the problem. Trial and error, or trial and success, because errors don't get you anywhere, may pay off with a quick, correct answer, but it could easily lead to an incorrect answer. So if I want pickles at Food City, I could do my algorithm going down every single aisle, or I could just go ask somebody, where's the pickles? Hopefully, if they work there, they'll know. But if you've ever asked people for anything in a store or work there, like I have, you find out that the people oftentimes don't know themselves. They're like, oh, it's aisle 7. And you go over to aisle 7, ain't no pickles in aisle 7. And you go ask somebody else, and they're like, I don't know, I just started working here 3 days ago. I have no idea where the pickles are, right? But you could also look up at the signs over the aisles, right? And you look for things like condiments. which would be a shortcut way of trying to find the aisle in which pickles might be located, at which point you might now combine finding the aisle with actually now going down the aisle in a more systematic fashion. But if you've ever been like me, you've actually gone down an aisle in what you thought was a very systematic fashion, said, this thing is certainly not here, and then you want somebody to ask somebody who worked there, and they're like, it's on that aisle you were just looking at, and you're like, nah, I'm sure it isn't, and then they go point you right at it. And you're like, oh yeah, I guess it is. I missed it. My algorithm was not as thorough as I thought it was. Probability. It's a probability that this class will end today without incident. It's a high probability of that. There is a remote possibility, very remote possibility, that something tragic would happen. That's the life we live in, the world we live in. There's a really good probability the sun is coming up tomorrow, or at least we're going to rotate such that it appears the sun is coming up tomorrow. There is a very, very remote possibility that something would happen that would prevent that from maybe us as individuals, probably more that than anything else, than the ceasing of the existence of the world itself. We deal with probabilities all the time. Is it going to rain today? People say, well, there's a 60% chance of rain. Does that mean it's going to rain? They go, oh, it's a 40% chance of rain. Does that mean it's not going to rain? So probability is interesting because if you say there's a 50% chance of rain, a lot of people say, well, that means it's probably going to rain, right? But what it says exactly is this. It's equally likely and equally unlikely to rain. It's the state of the greatest uncertainty, right? I know the least amount about whether to rain or not rain if it's a 50% chance of rain. If it was 40%, it's less likely to rain. If it was 60%, it's more likely to rain. But it's 50%, it's like flipping a coin. It may rain, it may not rain. So probability is important, and we'll talk more about it on Wednesday. Y'all have a great day. I'll see you then. We stopped off on probabilities. And we figured that, hey, probabilities are good. The world's not yes, no, true, false. The world is complicated, but we tend to act like it's not complicated. We tend to think that we can make heuristic shortcuts to understanding the world around us. And a lot of times those can be valid, but oftentimes when they're not valid, we don't know it. We're not faced with any real consequences. And so those heuristics seem to be useful. They wind up being kind of stock responses that we have to issues in our lives. So if you remember, we were talking about interpretations and problem solving and fixation and mental set. The way we do things tends to become the way we do things. And realizing that probabilities offer some complexities in our life, they also offer some interesting solutions so that we understand things now not in true, false, black, white, yes, no, but maybe. There's maybe involved here, especially the human beings.